So I'm joined here today for this episode of The Vote by Tom Lambert from the Carers Centre. Welcome to The Vote, Tom. So the Carers Centre, it's been quite a long established organisation in Brighton. Just tell us a bit more about it, because it does a really important job, doesn't it?
Yeah, thanks for having me, Mark. The Carers Centre has been supporting unpaid family carers in the city of Brighton and Hove since 1988. Yeah. So it was actually established by a group of carers in the city back then who realised that there wasn't really much emotional support for them in the role that they undertake at home. So they established the organisation, started off as a very much grassroots movement and became a formal charity in the very late 80s.
Yeah.
And then we started taking on the role of supporting young carers as well from the mid-90s onwards.
Yeah, and that last point's really important. There's, we were saying about 2,000, at least 2,000 young carers in Brighton, and that's quite a striking figure, isn't it?
It certainly is. Yes, we think about 2,000. That's extrapolating national data from research that's been undertaken. And we actually only know for certain, though, of about 300 to 400 who we've worked with and supported in recent years. So
yeah.
Clearly there's lots out there that still need to be identified and supported.
Yeah, and you represent all carers, and that the job of caring for a loved one or for a friend, that's becoming even more relevant and important nowadays, because it's just a lot of people doing it, isn't there?
So. Yeah, for sure. We support carers from the age of 6 up to 106.
Yeah.
What they've all got in common is that they'll have a relative at home who either has a physical disability, a long-term illness, or a mental health condition, or a substance misuse issue. And again, going back to the national data, we extrapolate that there could be as many as 28,000 adult carers in the city.
Yeah, that's a lot.
That's a lot.
Yeah. So, what can you do to support them and to represent their interests?
Yeah. So the Carer Centre offers a number of different supportive elements. We have general information and advice, so making sure the carers understand what their rights are, what they're entitled to. And help them to make sure they get their statutory carers assessment, which is important because that establishes what they are entitled to from the council.
Yeah.
And then beyond that, the assessment stuff, we offer enhanced emotional support for those who are caring for someone with a life-limiting illness.
Yeah.
Which is really important. Obviously, yeah. A crucial time of life, people need that additional guidance.
Yeah.
And sort of somebody to talk to. We have also quite an unique project, we think, called the Reablement Project. Now, what that does is it gives carers the chance to meet with a skilled volunteer to learn something new, a passion or an interest that they have that they really haven't had the chance to follow through with due to their caring role at home. So it could be a volunteer that's a musician, helping them to learn an instrument. It could be a carer wants to learn a new language, or it could actually be a carer who's looking to maybe dip their toe to get back into work. And so they might get supported by one of our volunteers to improve their CV, work on interview skills and things like that.
Yeah.
So that's the Reablement Project. And then we offer a number of respite opportunities, so trips, a chance for carers to get together and share their stories. And feel that they're not alone in their caring role in the city.
So. Yeah, and I think they're really important. I mean, firstly, I think with having that private time and if you're caring for someone, having time to kind of make sure you yourself are kind of healthy and strong enough to take up the caring task. But also, I think respite's important as well, because sometimes when you're caring, you need time to yourself, don't you? So you're able to do the caring role, properly.
Absolutely, yeah. You need to be at 100% yourself. You need to have internal resiliency, which most carers do, but they need a boost from time to time. Like anybody else, they get worn down by a day-to-day role, and they're living it. It's not like people who can maybe go to a stressful job in the day but still come home of an evening. Carers are living with challenging situations 24/7.
Yeah. So what else? What does it look like? So for example, if you were, if someone was, taking up one of your courses to kind of get additional skills, you provide a carer to look after their loved one.
Because
that's often a problem, a reason why people don't do it in the first place, right?
Yeah. So we do have to have a number of solutions to that issue of how is the carer going to be able to leave the family home, even for a short break. So first of all, we go back to what I said about making sure carers are entitled to their carer's assessment. Now, what that will establish is whether or not home help can be provided by the local authority. And in those situations, of course, it frees up a little bit of time for the carer to come to our activities. But then, even if they're not entitled to that sort of support from paid carers, we are reablement volunteers often make home visits, as do our emotional support staff. So there's a chance for carers to receive support without leaving the home. But then we also have another project as part of our partnership, which we call the Carers Hub. And what that does is it offers carers the chance to attend health appointments for themselves, be it GP, hospital appointments, or well-being type appointments. And in those situations, we're able to, with our partners at Crossroads Care, bring in a paid carer to look after the person with the disability while the carer is receiving their own support.
Yeah, so that's really important. And the Carers Hub is a broad mix of organisations, is it, including the local council, Brighton Hove City Council?
Exactly, thanks, Mark. Yeah, so we are the Carers Centre, that's our organisation. But the Carers Hub is a partnership, and it's between ourselves, the local authority, Crossroads Care, who I mentioned, and also the Alzheimer's Society. So those are the four members of the Carers Hub partnership.
Yeah. Why do you think it's not really recognised, carers in general giving support? It's not really often spoken about, is it? And it goes unnoticed, doesn't it, in society, by and large?
It does. Number of reasons. I think, firstly, the carers themselves take it in stride. It's part of their everyday life. It's what comes naturally to them. And typically they're not the sort of people that go out there looking for lots of recognition and praise. So it's up to organisations like us to actually shout out the important work that they do, the incredible amount of money that they save statutory organisations by doing the caring work that they do. But other reasons why they're not recognised is perhaps the term carer itself can be quite challenging at times. For someone to actually acknowledge that their loved one is a carer for them can be quite a sort of a barrier to get through. So we have to work quite closely with families sometimes to allow them to realise that what we're talking about is that they're just impacted or affected by the health condition of their loved one, and that can be a caring role.
Yeah. So what can we do to better recognise carers? And we can go onto this in the second half, but what more can the government do and a local council? What if there was one thing that you would like to see from the government? Probably going to be funding, but what would it be if there was one? If you had a magic wand and it was...
Well, funding would be great, sure.
Yeah.
I think one thing that would help, and it's not too far away now, is the next census, actually. The last census, of course, was done in 2011.
Yeah.
And I just don't think there was enough guidance for... There's a carer's question in there, but really no guidance about what that meant. So if it was more widely known, actually what we mean by the term carer, that we're talking about people who are emotionally affected, not just the people that are doing loads of personal care and washing and dressing of people, but those who are providing emotional support as well, it would enable carers to self-identify. We'd have a much stronger evidence base as to how many carers are actually out there. And that, in turn, would hopefully lead funding to go in the right direction to support them.
Yeah, and you cover everyone from, what to you, what's the term carer, who does it cover? Because it's quite a broad term, isn't it?
So really all that we're talking about is that the person that the carer is looking after is somebody with a diagnosed health condition. So as I say, it could be an illness, it could be a disability, but something that affects them long term. And the carer themselves, we don't have any strict criteria on what they need to qualify to get our support, but there are some instances where you have to evidence the amount of care that you provide. For example, if you're to receive the carer's allowance benefit, then you need to evidence that you're providing 35 hours or more of caring per week.
Yeah. So what are the benefits available to people? Because there is there's been a reform of the benefit system. So what is the main benefit carers get nowadays?
So it is called carers allowance.
Yeah.
As I say, you have to be caring for 35 hours or more a week to qualify, and also be earning under a certain amount per week. But it's really just sort of an auxiliary benefit to those which the cared for person will typically be getting. So often the person that's being looked after will receive things like PIP, which is personal independence payments, or ESA if they're no longer able to work. So carer's allowance tends to bolster those other benefits.
Okay, we'll leave it there for now. Join us for the second half, where we'll be speaking to Tom about an upcoming event on the 12th of June that the Carer Centre and the Carers Hub are going to be organising. So welcome back to The Vote, joined here by Tom from the Carers Centre. Tom, we were just talking off air about, you know, how carers, many carers are kind of put into that position to care for a loved one and not really prepared, because often the unexpected happens, someone gets diagnosed with a long-term condition, cancer or something else, and so they kind of put there, it's often on their own, and it's a really daunting experience. I know that from firsthand. So. You know, what can be done about that to get people better prepared? I think maybe the first thing would be for someone to pop in and kind of give them some initial guidance, I think would be useful.
Yeah, absolutely. So it kind of goes back to what we said earlier about if the community was more aware of carers and the caring role that they undertake, then people would be more aware of what might be on the horizon.
Yeah.
We believe that at least one in three people in the community will be carers at some time in their life. So it's affecting a huge number of people, albeit it might not be affecting them now, but it will be further down the road. What I would encourage anybody to do, if they feel that they themselves are a carer or they know somebody who is, I would encourage them to contact the Carers Hub in Brighton, who can provide information, advice, and signposting to the relevant services.
Yeah, and we'll put up details about that as well in the programme. So do you think people nowadays have the skills to be good carers? Obviously, people have busy lives, don't they? So it, you know, sometimes you just basically have to put your life on hold, don't you, to care for a loved one, particularly if it's a kind of a terminal illness. And it's a really difficult thing to do, isn't it, when you've got, you know, maybe the two adults in the household might be working, for example. It's a really tricky thing, and it's just, it's really not recognised, is it, by government, I don't think.
No, it's not. And it is. Obviously, it's a life-changing situation for people. We try our best to support them through that and mitigate the changes in their lives by offering them the respite opportunities, but also some informative workshops as well that we offer. So we've recently done workshops on first aid for carers, also manual handling. So a lot of people having to do lifting at home, and we make sure that carers are upskilled to be able to do that sort of thing safely.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Tell us a bit more about your event then on the 12th of June. It's with the Carers Hub, isn't it? It's a festival.
Yes, that's right. So we're really excited about this. This is happening on Wednesday the 12th of June.
Yeah.
That is actually right in the middle of National Carers Week. So everyone should be aware of that. That starts on the 10th to the 17th of June is Carers Week. And the Carers Festival itself is really the flagship event of the week. It's being held at the Open Market on London Road in Brighton.
Yeah.
And it's going to have all sorts of exciting things going on. We've got, I think it's around 35 different stall holders, so there'll be loads of information out there for carers to access in regards to all different agencies providing support in the city. But loads of fun stuff as well. So we'll have a well-being zone where you'll be able to receive hand massage, and we're doing workshops in boxer size, all sorts of different crazy stuff.
Yeah.
And also our young carers have a weekly youth club or drop-in, And for 1 week only, they're bringing that drop-in event down to the open market, the festival site, so young carers will be able to share their experiences and have fun in a unique and quite exciting setting.
And so when's that, what time does it start on the 12th of June?
So I should preface it by saying that actually in the morning on the 12th, also at the open market, we've got an event for employers.
Yep.
So that is 8:30 till 10. And that's going to be offering employers the chance to look at some of their internal policies, to think about, are we carer friendly as an organisation? Could we be offering carers more flexible working hours? How can we prevent carers from giving up work just to care full time? So that's the early event. The Carers Festival itself runs from 2 p.m. until about 6-ish.
Yeah.
And there'll be loads of great activities, as I've already mentioned, but also free tea and coffee for carers.
Yeah.
Of course, with it being a public space, you'd be like, well, how can you prove that you're a carer? Well, there's a carers card scheme in the city, which gives you loads of discounts to lots of different shops and leisure centres and things like that.
Yeah.
And if you don't already hold a carer's card, so evidence that you are a carer, you'll be able to fill in a simple assessment form on the day and get your carer's card there and then. So that'd be good.
Great. And so what are some of the other organisations that are involved? We know we've got the council, the Alzheimer's Society.
Yeah.
Any others that you want to mention?
Yeah, so we've got a number, actually. Let me remind myself of my list here. We've got Changes Ahead, who provide support for carers of those with mental health conditions.
Yeah.
We've also got East Sussex Fire Service, providing advice about being safe at home and making sure that your smoke alarms are fitted correctly. We also have Possibility People, who provide advice to disabled people in our city.
We featured them on the news recently. Yeah.
Excellent. All sorts. Brighton and Hove Libraries are going to be there, and many others.
Great. You mentioned a really important point about the employment and getting a job when you've got care. I think personally that then the employment industry is nowhere near prepared to deal with the increasing volume of carers going into the workforce, flexible working, maybe wanting a job that doesn't have so much responsibility, taking a step back in your career rather than wanting to go up the career ladder. I mean, they seem to be completely and utterly unprepared, particularly in this country, in my experience. So there's a big job to do there. So I wonder where can we start? Because I think people just assume you always want to go up the career ladder, but some people actually want to take a step back down and care for a loved one.
It's a really tough one.
It really is.
I think a starting point is the fact that we have an employer advisor within the carer centre.
Yeah.
And she does amazing work with employers just to have a look at things. What's the overall picture? Do you have many people working for you right now who are carers that you're just not aware of? So upskilling employers to be more aware of the situations for their employees.
Yeah.
But then beyond that, it's probably it's important to gauge the size of the business as well.
Yeah.
So we've got the local authority are doing great work now. They're starting a series of workshops for carers who are employed by the council, providing advice and guidance to those employees. And then also, we're lucky enough to have the chairman of our trustees works for American Express.
Yeah.
And again, they're looking to implement a series of flexible working options for the carers that work for their organisation.
Yeah.
Of course, the smaller the business is, the harder it is to adapt, because one cog in a small business plays such a bigger part as a percentage compared to larger organisations. So it's tough. But what we say to employers is to just try to get through to the carer, encourage them to express their experiences and what they're going through at home, and work with them to prevent burnout, really. What you don't want, what I'm sure no employer wants, is for the carer to take extensive sick leave themselves through stress or other reasons. Is there any ways you can mitigate that through flexible working hours, or, as you said, the opportunity to perhaps reduce to fewer hours per week,
yeah,
but still to maintain an active contribution to wider society?
Yeah. And do you see any pointers that might improve in the future? As you say, there are bigger organisations like American Express that, to be fair, they've got they can pull put resources into that. Yeah. If you're a small local shop, for example, it's a different kettle of fish. So I kind of get that. So maybe companies will be more responsive in the future. But do you see any kind of light on the horizon?
Yeah, there's some green shoots. I think it's kind of tied into the stigma that we're breaking down around mental health more generally.
Yeah.
Carers are proportionally far more likely to experience mental health issues than the rest of society. But as we begin to break down the stigma attached to mental health, which is something that exhibits in the workplace when people are stressed, it actually is serving carers well at the same time, because if you're less inhibited about bringing out problems around your emotional and mental health with your employer, then you're also more likely, I would say, to discuss your caring role at home if you have one.
Yeah, and just to finish up on the mental health issue, that what is good about that at the moment is that people are talking about that a lot more now.
Yeah.
Particularly when I was at school, no one really spoke about mental health. Now it's fully on the agenda, isn't it, now? And people are being more open about it, which can only be a good thing.
Exactly. We're making strides, but there's still a long way to go. But that said, we are doing good work with the NHS Mental Health Trust in Brighton and actually more widely in Sussex. So we're doing some good partnership work there so that those with a mental health condition are supported, of course, but that also carers are involved in the care of those people with mental health conditions, and that their needs are considered as well.
Yeah. Okay. Tom, thanks for coming into the vote today. All the best for the event on the 12th of June, and I'm sure we'll catch up again soon. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Goodbye to love.